they don't give any teacher a work day, then they're not in the contract for teachers. So I think they switched early out to March, I think, because I think the requirement for teacher work time on campus without students is a 1 year requirement, whereas student hours is a per semester requirement. So they took away some of the teacher work time per semester to make up for student hours, and they have to give us that teacher work time at some point. So they're giving it to us randomly in March.
So they only added two more full days.
Yes, they added two full days, and then those partial days in December, and then some other partial days. So pretty good. And the exam week in May is still early out, so that's really good too. Teachers, we get a lot of work done in May when we leave after exam, that last hour. So. We also, I think I mentioned this before, we work a little extra hour. Every day we work 15 minutes more than required, and that really helps. So the school is 15 minutes longer, and that really ends up over the day. So sometimes we do extra. SAT is going to just throw in more letters than we typically see. So. What I see here is a factored form of a quadratic. A is 15. The middle number, which everybody knows we typically call B, they're actually calling C. That's annoying. And then the last value is 14. So when I try to multiply this out, I do the first outer inner last to get this. I can kind of predict what I think will be there. I know 2 times 7 is making that 14, but I don't know how A times B is making 15, x squared. So whatever A and B are, when they multiply, they make 15 x squared. So I'm thinking maybe this is 1 times 15, or maybe it's 3 times 5 to make 15. That's pretty much everything I would consider there. I think maybe it's 1x plus 2, 15x plus 7, because 1x times 15x would make 15x squared. Or maybe it's 3x plus 2, 5x plus 7, because 3 times 5 is 15. It's really all I could predict for the numbers that go in those A and B spots. So, or maybe it's switched, right? Maybe it's 15 first and then 1. Or maybe this would be the 5 first and then 3. So, with these options, I could just multiply them all out and try to figure out which one answers the question. It says for all values of x, a and b make 8. What are 2 possible values for c? So they're trying to ask what could be in the middle here. So from here, if you haven't figured this problem out yet, go ahead and multiply these out. I'll give you a moment. You can figure it out. I really don't check enough, so I'll do the first one. I'm gonna do 1x times 15x, 15x squared. 1x times 7, 7x. 30x, 14. 15x squared plus 37x plus 14.
Good morning, teachers. Please pardon this interruption. At this time, please send students with testing passes to their testing sites. Again, please send students with the testing pass to their testing sites. Thank you.
So when I put 1 to 15, I end up with a 37. 50. What's supposed to be in the middle? 37 isn't any of these. So.
Okay, so
it's 37
plus
50
equals 31 is here, so I'm thinking it's letter D. Does anybody know why 37 and 107 weren't in the options?
Right. Yes.
Alright, yes, this little detail that I haven't even spoken about is there. Just a little clue, a little hint to help you feed your problem along. I did figure out the answers without having to look at it, but there's a clue here that the A and the B should add up to 8. So that tells me that my first two, where I was trying 1 times 15 and 15x squared, that I didn't even need to try these. It says that A plus B is 8, so that means I really should have only been trying the 3s and the 5s to get to 15. Okay, so the answer is D. Good job, everybody. Pretty neat way they figured out how to ask you about factoring without coming out and actually asking about factoring. You know? If they just had it factored and said what are the factors, then everybody could just guess and check. Alright, let's head to yesterday's assignment, page 221. I assigned all odds, so hopefully you checked your first set of problems there, like example one, it says factor and solve. So when I look at the left side, I see there's a 16 there. That's called a perfect square trinomial. The square root of 16 is 4, so it factors x minus 4 times x minus 4, written as x minus 4 squared. Square root both sides. And the square root of 25 is 5, remembering the plus or minus sign. add 4, and you have two possibilities. It's 4 plus 5 or 4 minus 5. 4 plus 5 means an answer is 9, and 4 minus 5 means an answer is 1. Number 3, square rooting 5 doesn't work. You would have a decimal, so you leave the radical bar over the 5 in this answer. You have the square root of 5 here. Add 9 over, and then you don't have to make two equations, because you can't add 9 to the square root of 5. So you can leave it. It's almost a little shorter when you can't square root. It's 9 plus and minus 9 the square root of 5. And then 5 and 7 are quite a bit trickier. 5, you're square rooting a negative. The square root of 100 is 10. Since it's negative 100, make sure you put the imaginary I. So this is 10i. You cannot add 12 to 10i. It's a real part and an imaginary part, so it's a complex number. 12 plus 10i, 12 minus 10i.
Then 7 is the most difficult for this part because of the
4 in front. I say I blame this 4. In order to factor 4w squared plus 4w plus 1, I square root the 1, square root the 4,
and the factor. 2w plus 1, 2w plus 1. Square root both sides.
So I subtract 1 over, and then it was
like this. 2w equals negative 1 plus and minus the square root of 75. Still trying to get w alone, divide by 2. So if you got this far, you really did well figuring out what to do with that 2. Negative 1 plus or minus the square root of 75, the whole thing is being divided by 2. The only issue
with this answer
is that 75 isn't in its simplest radical form. Did I show this yesterday? I may not have.
The square roots of 75.
You have to simplify, you have to think about it like the square root of 25 times the square root of 3. And the square root of 25 is 5. So that one little bit of the answer, the square root of 75 has to be rewritten 5 root 3. And your calculator does that, so you want to just type it in and check it out. So this is how your whole answer is written. It could be written more formally, like negative 1/2 plus or minus the square root 5 square root 3 over 2. So you can split it up so it's a fraction plus or minus another fraction. Alright, and then on the last half, there it was a two-part problem. I should see the number that completes the square.
So you take your middle number, divide it by 2, and square it. So 12 divided by 2 is 6. 6 squared is 36. All of these are doing b over 2 squared. And then you also have to write it in factored form. So number 15 was more difficult than the other two.
When I come by, let me know if you have a question.
even see the last one.
A little trickier.
169 over 4. Put these two things together, the first type of problems and the second type of problems. Here's the plan. These are our steps for solving by completing the square. Yesterday we solved by square rooted and then we figured out how to complete the square, but now we're going to put those two things together. This is when A equals 1. So the first thing you do is you move whatever is in the C spot to the other side. Because it's typically not a very good number. It's not a perfect square. And then you create a brand new C using B over 2 squared. When you make your new C, you put it right in there. Remember to add it on both sides of the equal sign. Then you're going to pick up right where we did number one yesterday. You factor and solve by square rooting. So I'll give you a few minutes to look at these steps, and then we're going to do 8, 9, and 10 on page 220 for your notes.
Okay, let's go to page
220 and solve. So we're completing a square. I feel like I don't like this better than factoring regular. And here we go. Okay. So, solve the equation by completing the square. I do want to point out the fact that this will not factor. It is set equal to 0. It doesn't factor. There's nothing that multiplies to 8 and adds to negative 4. So that's not an option here. So we're going to have to utilize some other skill set. So first, we want to move C to the other side, because when we're doing our little factoring riddle, we can't figure out any numbers to rewrite this. So let's just get rid of this one, and we're going to put something else in there. So I'm going to subtract 8 over, and it's going to be x squared minus 4x. I'm going to leave in a blank space and a negative 8. Now I'm going to put something better here instead of this. So I leave a blank space. Now, today, since I'm working with a full equation, I am going to have to add a number in here, and when you do one thing on the left side of the equal sign, you also have to do it on the right. So I'm going to put a blank space over here as well. Blank space on both sides. So first you move C, then you leave enough room on both sides for a new number. Alright, let's make a new number. We're going to make a new, better number. So what would be a new, better number? There's one very specific number that's going to work better than all others, and that's going to be whatever b is divided by 2 squared. So use your formula to put the best possible number in there. In this case, b is So I'm going to do negative 4 divided by 2 squared, which is negative 2 squared, which is 4. And y'all can just type away in your calculator if you want on that part. So 4 goes in both of my blank spaces. Goes on the left side and the right side. And 4 is going to work better than the number that was. So now I'm going to factor square root and solve it out. So my new problem that I've rewritten is x squared minus 4x plus 4. Because negative 8 plus 4 is negative 4. Any questions at how I arrived at my new problem? Alright, so this thing that I just created is a perfect square trinomial. So that can factor using square roots. So that's going to be x minus 2 times x minus 2. Equals negative 4, or I guess we can write that as x minus 2 squared equals negative 4. And now it kicks off just like yesterday. Square root both sides. Like definitely not out of room. Get a big square root bar. X minus 2 equals plus or minus 2i. So, main reason we went through all the operations with I in the last section is just so we could finish this particular problem correctly.
We have to remember every time we square root and we have a negative, we need to write I with that. Two. Wow, two's in the same color. I like to make a different color. And now I have x is 2 plus 2i and x is 2 minus 2i. And that's the answer. Let's just do 9. Let's not do. Well, does 12 have a. Okay, let's just do 9 next. You guys want to start 9 before me, or should I just get right into it? You ready for 9? Yeah? Aubrey, you ready for 9? You ready? Wyatt, you ready for 9? Okay. Let's do 9. Ricardo, you ready for 9? Okay. Ricardo, do you know what we should do first? What? We're going to move that 5. Let's get that 5 over there. Whatever is in that C spot. As a problem solver quadratic, I'm thinking, does anything multiply to negative 5 and add to 8? No, can't be factored. What's happening here? Let's get the 5 out of here. Factoring is not going to work. So now I have x squared. That was sad. Start now, please.
Galaxy tab.
Thank you.
Thank you, magic.
Technology magic. Okay. Let's see. Where are we going? So I'm going to add, so here's my problem now. It's x squared plus 8x. I'm going to put a blank space where that 5 was, and I'm going to put in something better than 5. I'm going to put in a number that works well with 8. I don't want just any old annoying number here. I want the right number. And the right number is this number divided by 2 squared. That number is going to make me be able to factor. The 5 was kind of ruining the whole thing. Moved it, put a new number in. You know what would be best for that 5 is a 16. 16 is really the only number I like to see next to an 8. Everything else is more complicated. 16 is the best number next to 8. You have to remember, if you're going to put a 16 on the left side, now that we're working with the full equation, you also have to put that same 16 on the right side. Good. Now that I have a 16 there, now I can actually factor this. What multiplies the 16 and adds to 8? Well, that's 4 and 4. So this is x plus 4 and x plus 4. And every time if you do it right, it's rewritten as a binomial squared, because it'll be a perfect square trinomial. And then from there, solve by square rooting. X plus 4 equals plus or minus the square root of 21 minus the 4, and x equals negative 4 plus. So there's actually a good chance that you, once you go through the flow of the steps, that you actually are more successful with this than factoring. Because the factoring issues, you had to make that table and figure out all the numbers that work for both criteria. And that can be daunting. Here, it's just like a systematic approach. So, I made the
10. You don't need to be a 10 unless you have some time to work on your assignment. But I do want to just point out there's something interesting about 10.
I've kind of
overflowed all over it. But so there is a value in the A spot. What I would do is just divide everything by -3 before I start the process. These are all divisible by -3. And then it would be x squared plus 6x plus 2 equals 0. So I just want to tell you, if there is a way to divide that greatest common factor, still do it. It's always a good idea. I'm not going to finish 10. I want you guys to do your assignment. So go to page 222. You're doing 21 to 28. This exact process we just did on 8 and 9. Well, because there's a 0 here and there's an equal sign, I can just divide it on both.